Welcome to the Audio Renaissance presentation of A Week in Winter, written by Marcia Willett, adapted for audio by Brenda Scott Royce, produced by Tony Hutz, and read by Josephine Bailey.
The lone walker on the hill shivered a little. The sun had set long since, sinking gently down, received by plump, cushiony clouds above a fiery sea. The glow was all about him, transforming these bleak moorland heights with a golden heavenly light. Far below, shouts and laughter drifted up into the clear air. He paused for a moment, watching the small figures of men as they prepared to stop work for the day. The old house was being renovated. Even from this distance he could see the evidence of it in the yard. Piles of timber, a small bonfire still smoking, ladders and scaffolding. A schoolmaster, recently widowed, he'd walked these paths for years, during holidays and half-terms, and could remember when the cream-washed walls had been bare granite and the yard full of cows. He'd heard the voices of children as they'd clambered on the swing beside the tall escalonia hedge and seen smoke rising from the chimney on cold autumn evenings. Now, an agent sign bearing green and white lettering leaned at an angle against the low stone wall, and the workmen were ready to go home. A pickup idled in the yard, whilst someone opened the farm gate, shouting to his companion who came hurrying from the barn. The truck was driven slowly through the gateway, waiting whilst the gate was shut and the man safely aboard, before disappearing behind the shoulder of the hill. The walker drew his collar more closely about his throat and walked briskly onwards. The house, built at the Moorgate, always reminded him of a poem he'd known from childhood. He murmured it aloud as he trudged onwards. From quiet homes and first beginning, out to the undiscovered ends. A sudden gust of cold wind came snaking over the moors. He bent his head against it, still trying to remember the next lines. A handful of chill rain made him blink, and he began to hurry, the verse forgotten, his mind now on supper. He did not see the muffled figure crossing the moor below the house, climbing swiftly over the dry stone wall. The clouds gathered overhead, and the rain began to fall steadily. Maudie Todhunter poured herself some coffee, sliced the top neatly from her egg, and settled herself to look at her letters. A rather promising selection lay beside her plate this morning, a satisfyingly bulky package from the Scotch House, a blue square envelope bearing her step-granddaughter's spiky writing, and a more businesslike missive stamped with an estate agent's logo, which she placed at the bottom of the pile. She slit open Posy's card with the butter knife and propped it against the marmalade. Posy's writing required concentration, decorated as it was with tiny drawings and exclamations, and often heavily underscored. "Don't forget," Posy had written, "that you promised to think about Polonius. Mum's saying that he'll have to go to the Dacres. Please, Maudie." Maudie shuddered. The idea of housing the boisterous Polonius, a large English mastiff, filled her with horror. "I am not a dog person," she'd told Posy. "You know that quite well after all these years." "Well, you should be," Posy had retorted. "Anyway, it's only for term times. I've made my promise I can have him at home for the holidays if I can find a home for him during the term. Mind you, she'll be spitting nails if she knows you've agreed to have him." Maudie chuckled appreciatively to herself as she spread marmalade on her toast. Selina had fought hard to prevent the alliance between her stepmother and Posy, but their mutual affection had been too strong for her. As soon as she was old enough to be independent, Posy had spent as much time as she could with Maudie, ignoring her mother's sulks, fielding her accusations of disloyalty, bearing with her ability to make life extremely tiresome. Posy was quite bright enough to know that Maudie might well house Polonius simply in order to irritate Selina, and she was ready to go to any lengths to keep him. Resisting such a temptation, Maudie opened the next envelope. Soft squares of tartan tumbled onto the table. Distracted from her breakfast, Maudie caressed the fine woolen samples. She examined them closely, reading the descriptions written on the white labels which were stuck to each square. Muted Blue Douglas, Ancient Campbell, Hunting Fraser, Dress Mackenzie. Miss Grey at the Scotch House had done her proud as usual. Maudie had been a customer at the Scotch House for many years, and her measurements were kept on file, but it was a while now since she'd ordered any new clothes. She'd been assured, however, that her file was at hand and that her order would be given immediate attention. Meanwhile, samples would be sent at once. Maudie had a passion for the texture and colour of fabric. Supple tweed in earthy shades, nubbly raw silk the colour of clotted cream, soft, comforting cherry red lambswool.
"You're so understated," Hector had said once. "Not like Hilda."
No, not like Hilda, who'd loved bright floral prints and fussy foulard frocks with pussycat bows. Not like Hilda, who held it an article of faith that a woman should make the best of herself at all times, who considered it an almost sacred duty to be good-tempered and forbearing at any cost. After a while, when Patricia and Selina made it painfully clear that she would never replace their dead mother, Maudie had made it almost a point of honour to be as different from Hilda as it was possible to be.
"Be patient," Hector had pleaded. "They're so young. It's still raw for them, and Hilda was such a wonderful mother."
Everyone had wanted her to know it. Voices lowered respectfully, eyes alert, eager for her reaction. A wonderful mother, a wonderful cook, a wonderful wife, a wonderful friend. Even now, Maudie still struggled against the resentment which had festered intermittently for 30 years, clouding happiness, destroying peace. And now Hector was dead, too. Maudie gathered up the scraps of material and thrust them back into the envelope. She took up Posy's card again. It was odd how the child's personality flowed out of the thin, spiky letters which carried the usual messages of affection, cloaked beneath sharp observations and teasing remarks. She refused to allow any concessions to Maudie's advancing years.
"I'm 72, child," she'd protested,
to which Posy had impatiently responded,
"So?"
Now she was suggesting that Maudie should drive to Winchester to see her new quarters, meet her fellow students, and share a pint or two at the local pub.
"We're in this old Victorian house," she wrote. "It's really fab. You'll like Jude. He's doing theatre studies with me, and there's Joe, who's doing art and stuff. She's cool. I've got this really big room to myself on the top floor. You've got to come, Maudie."
She laid the card aside and looked almost indifferently at the last letter bearing the Truro postmark. Far too early, surely, for the agents to have a buyer. Moorgate still had the workmen in, although they were at the clearing-up stage. Hector had always insisted that she should have Moorgate. The London house should be sold and the proceeds divided between Patricia and Selina. Maudie would have an annuity and Moorgate, and, of course, the Hermitage. Here, in this colonial-style bungalow, a few miles to the northwest of Bovey Tracy, she and Hector had spent their summers ever since he'd retired from the diplomatic corps. Maudie's father, a rather solitary man, had bought it for his own retreats from his desk in Whitehall, and Maudie had always declared that she would live in it if anything happened to Hector. Her friends had not believed her.
"Extraordinary," they said now to one another. "Oh, haven't you heard? Maudie's gone native in a wooden bungalow down in the wilds of Devon. Mind you, she was always a bit odd. Not quite cut out for the motherly bit. And I wonder if she didn't give darling Hector a bit of a hard time. Well, we all adored Hector, didn't we? Of course, Hilda was a brick, my dear, an absolute brick."
Maudie knew what they were saying and revelled in it. Once married to Hector, she'd acquired a reputation for tactlessness, for laughing at quite the wrong moment, for a worrying lack of respect for the hierarchy. The men liked her, despite these failings. Those years she'd spent at Bletchley Park during the war, and her subsequent appointment as assistant to a well-known research physicist in America, lent her an odd glamour, which some of the wives resented.
"And that's what attracted Hector," murmured Maudie, picking up the long white envelope. "After Hilda's perfection in the home, he couldn't resist the opportunity for fun. And we did have fun, when the girls went around to disapprove and make him feel guilty. There had been more disapproval, especially from Selina, when they learned that Moorgate was to be left to Maudie.
"My whole childhood is wrapped up in that place," Selina had declared dramatically. "We always spent the summer at Moorgate with Mummy."
"But what would you do with it?" asked her husband, Patrick, trying to suppress his embarrassment. "It's been agreed that Maudie should sell the house in Arlington Road. What more do you want?"
Maudie had appreciated his partisanship, but had no wish to be made out as a martyr.
"I wouldn't want to stay in London without Hector," she'd said abruptly. "I shall have my father's house in Devon, and an annuity. Moorgate is my insurance policy. Hector knows that neither Patricia nor Selina would ever use it or could ever afford to keep it without a tenant in it. He believes that the money you'll get from the sale of the house in Arlington Road will be enough to give you plenty in reserve for almost any emergency."
Preparing to leave, she turned to Selina.
"Shall I tell your father that you're unhappy about his plans?"
"Of course. There's always the possibility that you might die first, and then all your worries will be over."
"So taxing, deciding what other people should do with their belongings, isn't it?"
Remembering the scene, Maudie chuckled again briefly, then grew sober. What would Selina say when she discovered that Moorgate was about to be put on the market? The elderly tenants had died, and Maudie had brooded long as to whether she should relet it or sell it. Expediency forced her hand. The bungalow needed a new roof, and her car should have been replaced long since. She would sell Moorgate and give herself a buffer. It would be a comfort to have a cushion between herself and the sharp realities of life. As she slit open the envelope and drew out the sheet of paper, Maudie wondered again what had happened to those investments of which Hector had told her years ago. She hadn't taken much notice at the time, but he had been scrupulous in showing her the extent of his portfolio. She knew that even after the purchase of her annuity, there should have been certain shares and investments which had not, after all, been mentioned in his will. Could he have changed his mind and given them to the girls much earlier? As usual, she dismissed this recurring thought. Even had he bound them to secrecy, surely Selina could not have resisted displaying her triumph to her stepmother. Yet it seemed impossible to imagine Hector having financial problems which he had hidden from her. She pushed the nagging question aside and read the letter from the agents in Truro.
"The work inside the house is almost finished, and we have already erected a sign to tempt any passer-by. However, Moorgate being in such a remote location, we shall mainly be relying on advertising and sending out the particulars. There is some problem about a key to the office, storeroom and cloakroom. Mr. Abbott has been intending to contact you about it since he is unable to renovate this part of the house. Perhaps you would be so kind as to contact me."
Maudie frowned. Surely she'd given Rob Abbott the full set of keys, having kept one spare front door key for herself and one for the agents. Rob wasn't the sort to mislay keys. Aged about 35, tall, tough, with a keen sense of humour, he'd appealed to her at once. He'd looked over Moorgate, making notes, cracking jokes, telling her that he'd given up his engineering job in London after promotion had made him more of an administrator than an engineer.
"Boardroom politics aren't my scene," he'd said cheerfully. "I like getting my hands dirty."
She'd listened to him, making tea for them both with an old kettle in the huge, bare kitchen, and then they'd gone from room to room whilst he showed her what might be done. His ideas were simple but good, and she decided, with one or two restrictions, that she'd allow him to go ahead if his price were reasonable. He'd encouraged her to visit two other properties he'd renovated, and she was privately impressed. He'd grinned at her.
"Wait and see. When I've finished, you won't want to sell her."
That had been at the beginning of the summer. Perhaps it was time to make a visit to Moorgate, to meet Rob again and to check out his work for herself. She'd made one visit and meant to go back, but the right moment had never yet arisen. Maudie decided that now it had. She would drive down to Cornwall, see Moorgate and Rob, sort out the problem of the key. She removed her spectacles and, rising from the breakfast table, went to make a telephone call.
Listening to the enthusiastic voice of Ned Cruikshank, the young agent in the office in Truro, Maudie was able to imagine him quite clearly, even though she had never met him. "It's an absolutely super property, Lady Todhunter, quite my favourite. I can't wait to start marketing it properly. It's just this thing about the keys to the office." His voice rattled on in her ear as she visualized the clean, floppy hair and scrubbed, fresh complexion.
"Mr. Cruikshank, I quite understand that the keys have gone missing, but I don't have a spare set for the office and the side door. What does Mr. Abbott say about it?"
"Well, you see, that's the whole point. He can't remember ever."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.